Yes, we've been, if you've been here, we've been using this book by J.D. Greer about the gospel. And I'm using that and using a couple different things from this series. So I'm going to review back where we were after I asked you this question, just to get you kind of thinking first. What are some of the things you would expect to see in someone's life if they have been saved? So if somebody's a Christian, they've gone from not a Christian to a Christian over some period of time, what are some of the things you would expect to see in their lives?
Their outlook on hard times looks different. Like, look at Tommy and think if it was somebody that wasn't a believer going through what he's going through.
Yeah.
The outlook is totally different when
that's good. Yeah. Yeah. Peace and trials. Yeah. Yeah, that's good. That's good, yep. Fruit of the Spirit's good.
I think you'd see people dropping their wayward ways.
Yeah, repentance. Yep, yep. That's good. What else do you think you see? Intentionally, I'm wording this is pretty vague. So.
Joy
is definitely a big one. Yeah. 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 Hey there. Anybody else? All right. Now I'm going to ask it a little more specifically. If you had just picked one thing that we should see in someone's life that they're a Christian, just one thing that you would know somebody is a disciple of Christ.
Love.
You and Jesus both. By this, all people will know that you're my disciples if you have love for one another. So it's not the only thing we see, but it is a critical thing.
Can I ask you a question on that?
Yep.
Is that specific to other believers, or
yeah, this verse actually is. Yeah, if you are my disciples, you have love for one another. And so we've done a couple studies different times on the one another's of the Bible. It's a good study. Like if you look up where it says there's one another. So it's talking about in the church, talking about brothers and sisters in Christ. Now, we can look elsewhere and say Christians also love all people, love your enemies, pray for those who persecute you. So we should be showing love to everybody, but this is the one distinctive thing, is the way we love one another as brothers and sisters. Yeah. Is that what you're going at? Getting at? Yeah. 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 And really I just wanted to introduce that idea. Wasn't going to chase that too far, unless you want to. I can keep going. But one thing, if there's one thing about Christians, it's love. All right. So we've been, J.D. Greer was writing this book out of a place of saying, yes, as a pastor, I can relate to this. You know, I can tell you about the gospel. I can explain the gospel to you, lots of things from the Bible. But feeling it and living out of a place of experiencing God's grace, many times those are different things. Knowing it in our heads and feeling it in our hearts, living out of that truly in our hearts is different. And so what he started doing was this, I think it's 4-part prayer, where just daily he reminded himself of gospel truths so that the information that we know in our heads about what Jesus has done for us makes it the furthest distance in the world, which is the 17 inches, I think I've heard it said. I don't know how far it is from your head to your heart. And to try to preach that to himself. And so we know the truth of the gospel, that though we are sinners, God the Father sent his perfect Son, Jesus, to live the perfect life and die in our place. And in doing so, took all of our sins, paid for them in full, went in the grave, buried all of our sins, resurrected to new life, so that everybody who believes in him would have that new life. And as Christ ascended to the Father, now we have the assurance, we have this confidence, this hope, knowing that we too will have eternal life and we too will be with God forever. We know that to be true. If we believe that, we are his children, and that's the good news. It's the good news. So we know that. And yet, day to day, how we live we don't always live out of that. We don't always live like that's true. And so so that was kind of where he was coming from. And so the two parts of this prayer that we've talked about before the last couple of weeks are, in Christ, there's nothing I can do that would make you love me more, and nothing I've done that makes you love me less. And so we talked about that week. We talked about what could I do to make God happier, or something like that. You know, like we many times approach God thinking, yeah, he hates me today because I didn't do the right things or whatever. He wants us to follow him. We'll talk about that tonight. It's where we're going in a minute. Loving our neighbor, but he sees us if we are believers. He sees us as he sees his own son, Jesus Christ. That's good news. It's really good news. All right. And last week we talked about this one, your presence. So this is us talking to the Father. Your presence and approval are all I need for everlasting joy. And so that is, I think, a remarkable statement because, like Caitlin said about, you know, as Christians facing the ups and downs of trials in life, man, there are plenty of reasons for us to feel justified to say, I've got no joy today. Like, I just got no joy. And yet, as Christians, we always have God's presence. And the one before this is about how we always have his approval. He loves us no matter what. So I've got his presence. I've got his approval. That's all I need for everlasting joy. Starting today, or whenever we became a Christian, and going forever. We always have reason for joy. And that's remarkable. That's about as countercultural as it gets. So I gave you a couple verses. I'm going to spend just a few minutes reviewing what we did last week because I want to kind of finish up. I thought we maybe got cut a little short. But just one of the verses I used last week, Psalm 16:11. You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. And your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Where's their pleasure? Where's their joy? In God's presence. That's where we find joy. So he said, if this statement's true, all I need is joy, then these two statements are true. If I have lots of things in life other than God's presence and approval, I will not trust in them for my ultimate joy. So when things are going great, when material possessions are abounding, and everybody's healthy and everybody's happy, when, you know, everything you want is going great, we still don't trust in those things for joy. That's not ultimately what gives us joy. Ultimately, it's Christ. It's being with God. And so then the opposite is true. When none of it's going our way, when I have very few things in this life, other than God's presence and God's approval, I won't despair because my joy remains. So you can take it all away, but you can't take Jesus away. So either way, I got joy. You can add all of it to me and give everything to us, and I still got Jesus. And so you didn't add to my joy. Jesus is the source of my joy. So that sounds really good, right? But day to day, that's really hard. Really hard. And so last week we used a bunch of these questions from J.D. Greer as idolatry detector tests. And some of these are pretty challenging. And what this helps us realize is that many of the good things we have from God are good gifts meant to be enjoyed and celebrated and delighted in. And we're meant to enjoy them. They're good gifts. If I give my kids a gift that I know they love, Lois is funny about those little Hatchimal doll things, you know, the kids girls are in. If I gave her one of those that I know she enjoys and she just, you know, threw it in the trash, like, oh, okay, that would hurt my feelings. Like, I gave you something I know you would like. So it's not that we don't enjoy gifts. It's just that our joy is in the gift giver. And so anything we have, it's okay to enjoy them. We should enjoy them. But where is your joy actually founded? That we don't want to lose any of the gifts he's given us. We don't desire to lose them. But if we did lose them, would we still have joy? That's what helps us understand whether we are trusting in Jesus or trusting in his good gifts. And so these questions help us just get at what are temptations for us to make something into an idol. So it could be something you most hope for in the future, the thing that you most worry about losing. If you could change one thing about yourself right now, what would it be? And if that thing never changes, do you still have joy? What's the something you've sacrificed the most for? Who is there for you in life that you feel like you can't forgive, so holding on to bitterness? When do you feel the most significant? What triggers deep sadness in you? And where do you turn for comfort? All those can be things that, your answers to those questions could just be gifts or things that have gone on. Or they could be a place that we say, this is where my joy is. This is what actually gives me joy. This is what gives me a sense of satisfaction in life. And if so, and it's not God, then that's an idol. I'm going to slow down. I feel like I just turned on the review session like 90 miles an hour. I feel like we didn't really pause and talk about that for very long last week. When you see these questions, do these help you identify potential idols in your life? And if so, I think we talked maybe just a minute, a couple people shared. We talked about family, kids, spouse. Caitlin said that spouse is a potential idol. Not calling you out, just saying. That's a common one. Anybody else, like, does this list help you think of an idol willing to share? Okay, if not. Some idols are bad things. You can make an idolatry. You can make an idol out of an addiction. But many idols are good things. They're just not God things. So it's not that having an idol, not that having something good is bad. It's just got to keep it in perspective. So last chance, idols. You want to talk idols? You know them. All right, you keep it in your mind. Yes, ma'am. What's that? Football. Yeah, Wanda. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, that's good. Yeah. Yeah. Yep. All right. If our joy depends on a gift from God, then our joy is not in God, but in the gift. We talked about that last week. So then where we landed, you're writing that down, Kristen? You're writing that? No, you go for it. I like that you take notes. I love that.
Yeah, I'm not writing that down.
Oh.
I appreciate you for asking.
No, okay. I just want to scoot past you. All right. So then where we landed last week was about how Philippians 4:13 is really not about winning football games, but about being content in all circumstances. Not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I'm to be content. I know how to be brought low and how to abound in any every circumstance. I've learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So that contentment, that joy, that everlasting joy, just with God's presence and approval. If we have that, then give me it all, give me none of it. I can still have joy. Doesn't mean it's going to be easy. Doesn't mean it's simple. But we can have joy because we've got God's presence and God's approval no matter what. No matter what. All right, so that brings me to the third thing, the third part of this prayer, which is this. As you have been to me, so I will be to others. So this is us speaking to God, or Jesus, maybe easier for us to think through for a second. As you have been to me, so I will be to others. So this is getting to now. The first two really are about just our beliefs, just about our comfort in God's presence, just about knowing Him. This now is translating into how the gospel impacts how we live. So starting with the first part of that phrase, as you have been to me, what makes it in that category? That God, as God has been to me, or as Jesus has been to me, before I can follow that and be that way to other people, I've got to think about how God has been to me. So, how has God been to us?
Given.
forgiving, grace. These are good words. What else?
Loving.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, the great commandments. Yep. Yep. Mm-hmm. That's good. All right. What else? Something else God has been to us. I'd put generous on the list. Far more generous than I deserve. We could probably make a lot much longer list, but
understanding,
absolutely. Maybe you're being hesitant because you know whatever you say, I'm about to say, hey, that's what you should be to other people. So you know, be careful what you say. God's been to you. Because that's where this is going. I saw this movie, and then I went to see a play. It's been done a bunch of different ways. Les Mis or Les Miserables, however you say it, it's French, the word. Has anybody seen those movies or play or the book? The book is like that. Yeah. The newer one with Hugh Jackman is like all singing all the way through. That's hard for people to do. Yeah, I saw it on live a lot. Some live theater I could do better. Anyway, regardless of what you think about it's incredible, super well done. So you might know the first 30 minutes or so or less. You get Jean Valjean's story.
He steals bread because he's starving, and from then on, I mean, this guy's after him.
Yep.
But the part that is just so God is when the priest, he steals silver from the priest.
Yep.
And they bring him back, and he opens it up, and he said, oh, I gave it to him.
Yep.
He didn't steal it from me.
Yep.
I mean, that's what, it was just total forgiveness.
Yep.
And it changed his heart.
Yep. Yep. I was hoping somebody could tell that story. I thought, yeah. Yeah, that's you'd get that in the first 30 minutes of the movie. It's worth 30 minutes of your life of either version of it to see this. Yeah. Well, I don't know how long, 3 hours probably. Yeah. Yeah. Victor Hugo? Yeah. So in case you didn't hear it, so Jean Valjean was in prison for a long time. Finally gets out and a priest takes him in, you know, just lets he's trying to get wherever, I forget where he's trying to go, but the priest just graciously opens up his home and says, you can stay here for the night. And Jean Valjean goes through the house, steals as much silver as he can get, and goes off in the middle of the night. Well, the police catch him, can identify the silver, they know it's from the priest, and so he brings him back, and the cops say, sir, this man is saying you gave this silver to him. Surely not. And all it would take was a one word, and that guy would be back in prison for the rest of his life as a repeat offender. And he said, no, I gave it to him, which is kind of a lie, but, you know, I gave it to him, and you forgot the candlesticks, and gives him something worth more than he had already taken. And the guy's just totally undone. And the line in the movie, I'm sure it's from the book too, the priest says to Jean Valjean, says, my brother, you no longer belong to evil. With this silver, I have bought your soul, and now I give you to God. He's saying, this is, I want this to change your life. It is. And so he experienced, that experience of grace transformed his life. And he goes on just, so many gracious things he does from there, because he was that way, and that that's not just a good French novel. It's in the Bible, too, lots of places. Does anybody know the parable of the unmerciful servant? Matthew 18. Let's flip there. I'll get Henry if you want to. Do you want to summarize that for us as we're flipping there? What's the parable of the unmerciful servant?
One servant had a great debt to a king or his lord, and he couldn't pay him. And his lord forgave him. He said, "He fell down and said, 'Have mercy on me, I'll pay y'all.' And the lord forgave him. Then he went out and he encountered a fellow servant who owed him a very small amount. And he started choking the man and said, 'Pay me all that you owe me. I'm going to have you cast in prison.'"
Yep. Yep. Yeah, so those numbers, I looked up the numbers because sometimes I don't want to exaggerate. You know, the Bible's a good enough story. I don't have to add to it, you know. So the number it gives is, here we go. 18. The smaller number is 100 denarii. 10,000 talents, and a talent was worth 20 years' wages. So just real rough general numbers, if I could just round them. Say $50,000 a year times 20 years times 10,000 would be $10 billion. That's the debt, you know, just round numbers. That's the debt that he owed to the guy. And he falls down before him, as Henry said, and says, "It's forgiven. Don't worry about it." He goes out, finds somebody that owes him money, 100 denarii. Denarii is about a day's wage. So let's say 15 bucks an hour, 8 hours a day for 100 days, $12,000. Just for giving $10 billion, somebody owes me $12,000. And he says, give it to me. So he throws him in prison, and the last line, kind of the moral of the story, and in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all his debt. So also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. J.D. Greer, helpfully, he says, I imagine when the disciples heard that story, they kind of rolled their eyes like, nobody would really do that. Like, if you were forgiven $10 billion, you wouldn't really go out and you know, choke somebody over this amount of money. And that's exactly the point. Like, if you really had experienced this, there's no way you could do that. You just could not do it. The only way, it's impossible to experience the grace of the gospel and not be impacted by it. It has to have an impact on your life if you've truly experienced it. The only way your life isn't transformed by the gospel is that you haven't truly experienced the gospel. So people who've experienced grace show grace. So let me ask you this. So here's that line. As you have been to me, so I will be to others. So when do you have opportunities to do that? or to specifically show grace? When do we have the opportunity to show kindness? What are some types of it? Obviously, there's plenty of opportunities, but when are... Yeah, some family giving you a hard time. And
my younger brother, he was drunk, and he cursed me out. And I said, "Bro, I love you, I forgive you." And that infuriated him.
Yeah.
He cursed me some more.
Yeah.
And I said, "Well," I said, "man, I'm going to sleep. You know, I got to take you home in the morning." And I said, so we got up in the morning. I said, "Come on, let's pray." And he's still so angry.
Mm. Trying to make amends.
No.
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 You don't know my younger brother.
No. Yeah.
And, I said, praise the Lord, then. I started talking to him. I said, man, you know, listen, man, ain't nobody perfect, man. I said, you my brother, you know my history. But I said, man, you got a problem. I said, Jesus can help you, but, you know, first you got
So when somebody, yeah, before I jump into that, what other examples, it doesn't have to be that specific, you're welcome to be, but what other, when else do we have opportunities to show grace?
Can I go into a story?
Sure, yeah, yeah. I just said you didn't have to be. But
I have a sister who graduated from Berkeley. You know about Berkeley.
Yeah.
It's the haven of communism on the West Coast. And she and I have, we're like this.
Yeah.
Big time. And the only time I ever did see her is when she went broke or something and she needed money and this and that, you know. And about 20 years ago, she, because of her lifestyle, she literally folded and she tried to commit suicide.
Mm.
And I saved her. I took her to the hospital, got her stomach pumped, the whole bit. And I never got even a thank you. Not even a thank you.
Yeah.
You know, even though we're like that, I'm going to help my sister, you know. So about a year and a half ago, just before COVID hit, I'd already moved her a couple times, helped her, did it all. I always try to, you know,
yeah,
do something good for her. And then last year when COVID just hit, she asked me, she thought she was going to do it again, kill herself, and over this whole COVID thing. And I just said, you know, she said, please come and see me. I need to talk to you. And I said, you know, I can't be going. Right now it's a pandemic, you know.
Yeah.
Nobody was going anywhere.
Yeah.
And I said, I'm not going to go anywhere, but I'm going to send you some money to help you. And I did. And I have never heard from her since.
Mm.
But I am waiting, because the day that she does call me, I'm going to not only forgive her, but I'm going to try to continue to help her.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
That's my opportunity.
Yeah, for sure.
Is that your only sibling?
My other sibling died.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah. Those were much bigger examples than I was thinking of. So,
yeah,
that's right. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, you know, you could have opportunities to show grace, just, you know, random, like kind of the random interactions we have day to day. You can choose to either, you know, make somebody's life hard, or make it easier, and. You know, but I think those examples are getting to what I was really going for, was that it's usually when we are wronged, like when something happens, it's not our fault. We were treated unjustly. Hey, you were against me. I didn't deserve this. That is the very opportunity we have to show grace. J.D. Greer talked about how when he got married, his first 2 years of marriage were really, really hard. And they just were always at each other. And the counselor pointed him to this verse. We'll spend just a moment on this. This is Paul writing to Timothy in 1 Timothy 1:15. He says, "The saying is trustworthy, deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost." Now, this is Paul. He writes, you know, half the books of the New Testament, more than that. And calls himself the foremost of sinners, like the chief of sinners. The New King James says chief of sinners. How in the world could he call himself the chief of sinners, the foremost of sinners?
He stood there and watched.
Yeah.
They killed him.
So that's how I've always read that verse, but it doesn't say was. I've always read it as I was the foremost of sinners, but he doesn't say was. He says I am. Wait a second. This is Paul. He's writing a book that's like, how much holier can you be? You're writing a book that's going
to
be a part of.
Maybe
so
Paul had a better and deeper understanding of the holiness of God in Christ.
Yeah. Yep. That's what I'm saying. The closer you get, the more you realize how much grace is.
Yeah.
And how we are.
How far we are from that. Yeah. Yep. Yeah.
Saw him crucified, was with him after he was resurrected. But when Jesus appeared to him in the book of Revelation,
said,
man, I fell on my face as I was dead.
Yep. Yep. Yeah. You read something?
I was just going to say that when James was stoned, I think Saul was part of that.
Stephen. Stephen was stoned.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, he was. He was holding
and,
the cloaks.
And
yep.
Knowing that, he was, you know, had he been there with Christ, he probably would have stoned Christ too.
Yep. Yeah.
I mean, so.
Yeah, I think he probably does have in mind his past, but I do think it's interesting that he says, I am. And so because he says, I am currently the foremost of sinners, I think he may know the past, maybe referencing that, but I think to their point, and I had never read it before today. I was reading this. I was like, well, that's interesting. And so I started reading about this. Yeah, I think it was not just about his past. The thing about the fact that he, the more he knew God, the more he realized how much of a sinner he really is. And it's having the humility that I know my sin more than I know any of your sins. And so from everything I know, I'm the worst sinner in the room because I know my sins better than I know yours. And I think that, yeah, having that perspective. And so that the counselor gave that to J.D. Greer in their first couple years of marriage as a way of saying this about ourselves. Think of ourselves first as a sinner and second as sinned against. So when somebody is angry or, you know, treats us unjustly and they sin against us, we could have this, you know, righteous, holy indignation, and it could be, you know, right, it'd be justified. But if first we remember, man, what they did to me was about worth 100 days worth of wages. But what I did to God was worth $10 billion. And if we have that kind of humility to say, yeah, I was sinned against. Absolutely. And there's, like, some of y'all have been sinned against big time. So, yes, it's a sin. It's wrong. But if we first remember we are a sinner, that gives us the capacity to show grace even in the ridiculously hard moments. Over and over again, this is just two examples, but Romans 12:19, beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay. Sometimes when somebody sins against us, we think, you know what, if I just give them a taste of their own medicine, they'll turn around, won't they? And they need to experience this on this end, and that'll get them on it. It does. We think in our the default position of our mind is revenge leads to repentance. If I get them back, then they'll see and they'll change from their ways. The Bible says something very different. Romans 2:4. Not revenge, but God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance. It's God's grace that changes our hearts. The law shows us our sin, but grace changes us. Grace changes us. You and I were not loved when we were pretty and perfect to God. We were not the perfect bride to Him that made everything great. We were still sinners, His enemy, when He died for us. And it's the kindness, when we receive that kindness from God, that changes us, changes our heart, and gives us the capacity to show grace to other people. So that this I think is a helpful, just statement. Think of ourselves first as a sinner and then sinned against. Whatever sin we're against, it's real. I'm not saying it isn't. And it will be repaid in the end, and we can trust that whatever justice we think we could give, or the government or anybody else can give, God is far more holy and has a lot more wrath than anybody else here. So we can trust Him. He will repay. It's not that we're saying people just get away with whatever they want to do. No, vengeance is His. He will repay. But that won't be my job. My job is to show grace and to say, I'm going to show you what I've experienced and let that, maybe God will use that to change people's lives. So that's why we're sticking with this. Here's today's phrase. As you have been to me, so I will be to others. That's the third part of that prayer. Is that helpful to you? Yeah. All right. Let's pray. God, I thank you for tonight. Thank you for the grace you have shown us. God, we confess that it's a lot harder for us to show grace than it should be. And so we pray that you'll lead us in wisdom and discernment as we seek to know you better, to seek to understand your grace better. And God, may we see that $10 billion debt that you forgave, and may we be gracious to those who owe us for the way they've sinned against us. God, we trust in you, and we pray that you'll lead us and guide us throughout this week. Bless each family represented here, and as we experience your joy, no matter what's going on, may that overflow and the way we love our neighbors. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Thanks for being here.
Don't forget my little prayer.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Lord,
yes,
sir. We'll see y'all Sunday.
Yeah.